Father, we thank you for this time together, and Lord, we just ask that you would bless it, and Lord, you give Joseph the words that you want us to hear today. Lord, we just ask that we receive them, Lord, and go about your business this week in doing your will. Father, thank you for Joseph, Jane, and David as they come here to serve us, and Lord, we just ask that you would continue to bless their family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy New Year. I hope your year has begun well, 2013. We thank God for his faithfulness. Probably it's your first time to come and worship with us. We just want to appreciate you. Somebody is your first time to come and worship with us? Yeah, we want to appreciate those two guys. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you for coming to worship with us, and you're welcome here again and again. 2 weeks ago, I thought I was preaching last Sunday, but I remember it was the fifth Sunday of the month, so it was testimonies. So that pushes my, and Tom did a wonderful job on that, plus Jim. And so that takes us to our series, to two more weeks. So it will be this Sunday, and I will finish the other one on a week from next Sunday, so, and we'll be done with eternity. So today we are on millennium. So what in the world is the millennium kingdom? So that's what will be our focus today. That's the topic that I want us to deal with today. And I want to take back to one of the song that was probably sung more than many times during the last month of December, during the Christmas season. And this song, Joy to the World, it's a Christmas song, isn't it? You know, that's the way we know it, and it was sung 100 times. But as you go through this song, and that's what I want us to do, we are not going to sing it, but as we see the words, Joy to the World, let us receive, Joy to the World, the Lord is come, let us receive her King and heaven and nature sing. That's the one?
Yeah.
Yes, there we go. That's the first stanza. Now, from that stanza, one question that we need to ask ourselves this morning, did mankind receive the King Jesus when he was born in Bethlehem? Something with the mic. Did they do that? Okay, Crass, I want you to talk to me. we sing that song. So, did mankind receive Christ when he was born in Bethlehem? No, they didn't do that. By the way, you read even in John, and you hear that he came to his own, but his own rejected him. That's what man did. That's why Jesus ended up being crucified, because mankind rejected him. Now, you come to the next stanza, it talks about the joy to the earth, the Savior reigns, let men their song employ, while field and floods lock, hills and plains repeat, and then repeating the psalm. And this is the next question. Has nature rejoiced in the coming of the Lord? Because that's what he's saying, that's what he's saying, that well, fields and floods and rock and hills praying, let it sing, let's pray, let it praise. And the question is, has nature rejoiced at the coming of the Lord?
No.
Has it?
No.
No. You read Romans, this is interesting, you read Romans 8 verses 22, and it talks about the creation has been groaning. The creation has been groaning, and what the creation is waiting for the time of its redemption. So this has not been that the nature has not rejoiced. The time of its rejoicing is not there. What it's doing right now, it's groaning. I'm just taking you back to the basic of the song. You know, it's a Christmas song, but and I'm not taking it out. I love the song, and I appreciate what Isaac wants to do, but I think it's more than that. So, the other stanza talks about this. No more Let seeds and sorrow grow. No thorns invest the ground. He comes to make his blessing flow, for the far as the curse is found. Far as the curse is found. And that raises another question. Has the curse been lifted from the earth?
No.
That's what he's saying, that, you know, he comes and makes his blessing flow far as the curse is found. So has the curse been lifted up from the earth?
No.
The last Psalm talks about that. He rules the earth with truth and grace and makes the nation prove the glorious of his righteousness and wonders of his love. That raises another question. Is Jesus ruling the nations of the world today?
No.
He's not. That's true. And so as far as we appreciate the song as a Christmas song, I think Isaac Watts, the author of this song, had something far than this. And what he was looking forward for is the Millennium Kingdom. That's where we see all the fulfillment of what he made from the song and what we get from the scripture. There is that time that we are waiting for the laying of Christ on earth, for the lifting of the curse from, you know, on the earth. There is that time. That will be our focus this morning. The Millennial Kingdom of Jesus Christ. And I hope this will motivate each one of us. The reason why I'm excited about talking what's going to come, because it's coming. And this just proved to me and to every one of us that this life is not all there is, brothers and sisters. And that gives me hope. That my 70 years, if I have energy to go 80 years, is not all there is. Grave is not my full stop. It's not the end of me. There is more. I'm looking forward for the Millennial Kingdom reigning with Christ. Now let's jump in there. Revelation chapter 20. That's our text today. Revelation chapter 20 talks about this real nice. But now it's interesting to note that as you open Revelation 20, that's the last book of the Bible. But it's interesting to note that the prophets in the Old Testament talked about this kingdom, talked about the reigning of Jesus Christ, you know, him being the Messiah and reigning in Jerusalem. They talked about that, but no one talked about the number of years. It's only seen here in Revelation. It's interesting how the Lord would hold all of that. They talk about, you know, he will reign with peace, with prosperity, with joy, with purity. It's all talked about that in the Old Testament, but nobody talked about how long it would be. But you come to Revelation, it talks about the 1,000 years. So, Revelation 20, verses 1 to 10. The Bible says this. And I saw an angel coming down out of heaven, having the key to the abyss, and holding his hand a great chain. He seized the dragon, the ancient serpent, who is the devil, or Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. He threw him into the abyss and locked and sealed it over him to keep him from deceiving the nation anymore until the 1,000 years were ended. After that, he must be set free for a short time. Verses 4. I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge, and I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus and because of the word of God. They had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ, and will reign with him for 1,000 years. When the 1,000 years are over, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather sand on the seashore. Verse 9. They marched across the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of God's people, the city he loves. But fire came down from heaven and devoured them. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the prophet had been thrown. They will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And that's the word of God.
Amen.
Amen. You see, the word millennium, which is at the center of our attention today, is a Latin word that combines these two words, miri and annum. Well, we get annum, our. So miri is 1,000 and annum is years. And then from there we get, and we have it in our handouts, we get the 1,000 years that's talked about here in Revelation 20. Verses 1 to 10. Now, the interesting bit is that it's repeated 6 times in this, from verses 1 to 10. The 1,000 years, 1,000 years, 1,000 years. And that's just big there. That shows you that this is not symbolic, as some people have found that this might be a symbolic thing. But this is 1,000 years. So, this is the reign of Christ, which begins at the second coming of Christ, where Terry stopped last time when he preached, about the second coming of Christ. And when he comes now, that's the second, when he comes angry with the righteous ones. Terry talked about that in chapter 19. When Christ comes with the righteous one, this is now the second coming of Christ, where he comes to inaugurate this millennial kingdom. Now, I want us to go through some of the views that have been proposed out there. There are 3 views, different perspectives on how people see about this, the millennial kingdom, or the millennium. And these 3 views, the first one that was popular in 1700 and 1800, but it's not popular now, is what they call the post-millennialism. The post-millennialism, this proposes that the view that Christ's second coming will occur after the millennium. That's what they see. Now, let's come on here. We are in the church age. That's what we have been. That's where we are right now. We are in the church age. But these people, this group of people, they believe that yes, after the church age, we enter in a millennium kingdom whereby things will be peaceful, that the spread of, because of the spread of the gospel, and you know, people become believers, and that's going to promote peace in the world, ushering a peace period. They think, and that's the affirmation, that right now Satan is bound. That's what these people believe. That right now Satan is bound, and so what's happening is to get to this, and then before, like 7 years before the second coming of Christ, then there will be the great tribulation, and after that, the second coming of Christ will, you know, we'll be there. They don't separate about the issues of the rapture there. And then they combine the battle of Armageddon and Gog and Magog. They combine them because they think that's one and the same battle, which the Bible does not talk about that. And then from there, it's going to be ushered into the millennial kingdom. That's their formation. Thank you. Thank you. Now, which way... So that's the whole deal. That's the whole deal with these people, that they think that Christ will come after the millennium, that that's the way it's going to be. But this is, you read the text, you read the Bible, this is really not true. It does not add up. And I'll give you the reasons for that. The reason is that they think that by the spreading of the gospel, sharing of the gospel, that's going to Christianize the world, making it to be peaceful, that things are going to go okay because of the spread of the gospel. And from history, now that's not true. This was famous in 1700s, but now that was before the World War 1, and then World War 2, which just affirms how, you know, mankind is, you know, how depraved we are. And even if there's the spread of the gospel, that's not going to bring the peace and the prosperity that we expect. So this has been there, but it's highly rejected. It's not accommodated. And then it does not interpret, it's not consistent with the interpretation of the scripture. The next view that's out there, I'm bringing this to you because you will hear them, or probably you have heard you know, people talk about them. The next one that's out there, the view of the millennial kingdom, is the amillennialism. The amillennialism. Now, when you see the word, the A, it negates the A before a word, it negates the meaning of the word. And so amillennial means that there will be no retro millennium, no thousand-year period of time. So the whole deal here is that the millennium, it's not there. It's a symbolic thing. It's just symbolic. What is there is the church age. We are right now in the church period. They combine that it's one and the same thing. It's just a symbolic, it's one and the same thing. So the church age and the millennium is one and the same thing. And so what we are waiting is the great tribulation, which will be for a ritual season there. And then they combine the battle of Armageddon and Gog and Magog, which is not true. And then from there, that's where the second coming of Christ, and then the eternity, the new heaven and the new earth. So that's the amillennialism. That's what they affirm. And they take the thousand years as a symbolic, that this is a symbol of just a long period of time. That you repeat repetition, and we talked about this the other time, that when you see something repeated in the Bible several times, especially in a verse several times, that shows it's important. So this repeated 6 times, I don't believe it's a symbolic thing. So that's what those people affirm, that the peace, also the peace and the prosperity that's talked about in the millennial kingdom, that this is, that's what they affirm, that this is the inner peace for believers. This is not like peace out there, but this is an inner peace. It's not a ritual one, it's just something that you have inside of you. So one view, one problem with this is that they try to spiritualize the text. We, you know, that what it is saying, what the text says, it's not retro, but it has another meaning on top of it, which is I don't think is right. So from what I have said, you can guess I don't belong in any of those two camps, but I belong to the third one, the pre-millennialism. So pre means more before. And this is what we have been talking about. I think this is really what we have been talking about. We have been saying that we are in the church period. That's where we are. That church period, that's where we are, and was inaugurated at Christ's death, when he died and the church was born, as we saw in Acts 2. So that's the church we are in, and here, in between here, before the great tribulation, we talked about the rapture. That will be raptured. We'll be taken to be with Christ for 7 years. And then that's the time the great tribulation will be there. And then Christ, together with the church, will come back to start the millennial kingdom. This 1,000 years, whereby from the text we learn that Satan will be bound. The version was just very clear. We read that this morning. That he will be bound. And Terry did a wonderful job talking about the Armageddon. This one, the battle of Armageddon, is different from the battle of Gog and Magog. You saw with the different, with the other two views, they were combining them. But the battle of Armageddon, this is when Christ and the believers, they will come, and Satan and the Antichrist and the false prophet will try to wage war against our coming. And that's where, you know, Christ, by just a word from his mouth, you know, he wipes them away. He takes the false prophet and the false prophet, who's the other guy? And the Antichrist. Those two guys. The false prophet and the other guy. And both of them are thrown into the ring of fire. And then Satan is bound for the 1,000 years. So that's what we, that's the battle of Armageddon. Then the 1,000 years there. And then after the 1,000 years, we read this morning, Satan will be let loose for a short time. We don't know how long, but for a short time. And then after that, that's when after Satan being let loose, try to gather some people to rebel against God. They will try to surround Jerusalem. And that's when the battle of Gog and Magog will be fought. Now, the good thing, we'll not be taking guns or do other things like try to fight them with food, but just by the word of mouth from the Lord, you know, just wipe the Satan down. And then from there, we go to the white throne judgment and then the new heaven and the new earth, which I'll finish 2 weeks from today. So far, that's what we have seen. And I hope that's clear. That eliminates a lot of this view. Eliminates a lot of trying to spiritualize the text. It just makes with good flow of interpreting the text, just the way, you know, I think it does make sense to me. So that's the one I'm proposing to you. This is the one that I see like the program that we are looking forward for. So that's enough. That's good. Yeah, this is all there. These are all good things about the millennial, the premillennial. But what's the purpose? What's the purpose of the millennial kingdom? Because it's there. What is the purpose? That's what I want to just focus on and finish with the last thing about the characteristic of what will be there. So, what are the purposes for this millennial kingdom? Because it will be there. Number one, this thing, this 1,000 years, brothers and sisters, it is there because it's a reward to God's people, to the people of God. This will be a reward. This 1,000 years is a reward to God's people. You know, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, there are many prophecies that talks about this kingdom. Now, I have given you texts and I'm going to read them, but in your handouts, you have all those texts so you can check them after this. But Isaiah 40 verses 10 says this. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm roots for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. This is what Isaiah is saying, that he's coming and he's going to reign, he's going to rule. But as he comes, he's coming with his reward to pay his people with him. And so this will be a time of reward. This 1,000 years is a time of reward. Matthew, Jesus talking about this in Matthew 16, verses 27, that for the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. This time, brothers and sisters, this 1,000 years that we are all looking forward, Christ is saying that he's going to come, he's going to rule, then he's going to pay each person according to what he has done in this life. So this is a kingdom we are looking forward. This is being prepared. You know, we are looking forward. Jesus talking about this in Matthew 25, 34 says this, that then the king will say to those on his right. Now this is after what we saw after the battle of Armageddon is over. And then the king will say to those on the right, those who are kind to his brothers, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. You see, precious people, these 1,000 years is a time of reward. Something that the Lord has prepared for those who believe, for those who trust in him, just laying with him, being there with the Lord, rewarding us, giving us what we, you know, what he wants for us in that peaceful reign with him. You know, there are many verses. Colossians 3:24 talks about the inheritance. Revelation 22 verses 12 talks about that behold, I'm coming, bringing my recompense with need to repay each one for what he has done. Many verses, Matthew 19, it is 20, talks about that. You know, many verses, I don't have time for them, but Colossians, 1 Corinthians 6 verses 2 talks about that. What we saw this morning, Revelation 20 verses 4 talks about that. It will be a time of pain, a time of reward to God's people. Now, we will be rewarded, and this is the challenge. This is where, you know, this world be surprised to us. Precious people, we will be rewarded based on what we did on this life. You remember the parable Jesus talked about, a person who was left to be in charge of cities? In the book of Luke, talked about that you are faithful in these 10 cities. Now I'm going to put you in charge of more. You are faithful in this. And also there's a parable of the talents in Matthew 25. Talks about the one who was given 5, 2, and 1. And each one received a promotion based on how faithful they were on what they were entrusted. You see, precious people here, we will be rewarded based on what we did in this life. And you see, that calls for you and for me to be faithful in this life, to make the maximum use of my time, of my resources, to serve the Lord faithfully, because that determines what I'm going to do in eternity, not in time, but in the millennial kingdom. That determines that. Remember, we will be coming with Christ to reign. You know, we are riding back with him to reign and establish these 1,000 years. And so, that will be determined by our faithfulness. What we'll be doing in those 1,000 years will be determined by our faithfulness in our present life. The question is, what are you doing for the kingdom right now? What are you doing for the kingdom? What am I doing for the kingdom? What am I doing with my life, with my time, with my resources? Because this is coming true. We'll be paid. The question is, are you faithful? Are you trustworthy with what the Savior, with what the King of Kings has entrusted to you? And because of your faithfulness in these three true things, in these 70 years, in these 60 years, in these 20 or whatever years the Lord gives you, He's going to put you in charge of many things in a kingdom of 1,000 years. That just calls me to give myself fully to the Lord. And I hope it calls you to do that. As 2019 begins, as we face this year, there is time for reward. This is coming. But he says, this is calling me right now, in the meantime, to be faithful with what the Lord has entrusted me. And so you can purpose this year. I'm going to make my time count for the kingdom. I'm going to make my money count for the kingdom. I'm going to make my relationship count for the kingdom. I'm going to invest for the kingdom. I'm going to be faithful with what he entrusts me with. Because that's going to determine what you are going to do. So it's going to be a time of reward, brothers and sisters. Number two, the purpose for this is to respond to the prophet's predictions. You see, this is the purpose of this millennium. God's word is true. And so this has to come, brothers and sisters. This has to be fulfilled so that what has been written in the text can be fulfilled. I have given you a lot of text there. Let me read a couple of few of them. Psalm 72, verses 11 talks about this. It says this. May all kings fall down before him. All nations serve him. You see? When will this be? When will this time of kings bowing before him and of all nations serving him? When will this be? A millennial kingdom has to be there so that all kings, all nations bow down and serve him. Remember, this is the reign of Christ, where Christ is the king. He's the one who is in charge, you know, ruling from Jerusalem. So this has to happen. You know, if the millennial kingdom is not there, then all the prophets, all the prediction that talks about the millennial kingdom will be left open. You know, they'll not be fulfilled, which cannot be. They have to be fulfilled because the God's word is true. You read Isaiah 9 verse 7, talks about that. Isaiah 9 verse 7, that of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forever. See, the Messiah government will be established. This has to be. This throne of David has to be fulfilled. And when is it going to be fulfilled? In this 1,000 years. Isaiah 60 talks about that, 60 verses 21, that Israel must turn treasuresness and inherit the land forever. That has to come true. Israel must inherit the land. That, not like the way it is right now, they just have a small bit of it. That has to happen. Zechariah 9 verses 10 talks about that. Luke 1 verses 32 talks about that, that Christ must rule over Israel as a Messiah in unbroken rule. You see, without the millennium, brothers and sisters, these and many other prophecies will go unfulfilled. And that cannot be with God's word. There must be a millennial kingdom for all the prophecies that talks about its fulfillment for them to be fulfilled. And you see, that's why I have a problem with people who just think that the millennial kingdom is just a symbolic thing. It's not a symbolic thing. It's a real, ritual thing that will be happening. Reign of Christ for 1,000 years. All the predictions that talked about his coming as a baby, they all came true. By the way, that's an interesting one. You know, if you want to know that even his second coming is real, that he's going to establish this reign, just look at his first coming. Are all the predictions that talked about his first coming as a baby, born in Bethlehem, be called a Nazarene, were all fulfilled literally or symbolically? Church. Were all symbolic or ritual? They were all ritual. So that tells you that even his second coming will be so ritual. It will be real. It will not be a spiritual thing out there. It will be just so ritual. If his first coming was that, even his second coming, you can take that to the bank, brothers and sisters. By the way, even the apostles were looking forward for that. You remember that in Acts 1 verse 6, it's in your notes. In Acts 1 verse 6, you remember now the apostles, the Christ has resurrected, and the apostles, you know, they still didn't get it. They asked the Lord, "Lord, are you now at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" You see, they were still looking for a kingdom whereby the Messiah will be the king. They were looking for that, even at that time. And Jesus did not assume what he, you know, like, "I don't care." What did he say? "That it's not about you to know when the kingdom will be restored." That tells you it's going to come. Precious people, the reign of Christ, 1,000 years, that's so real. That's true. All the prediction I talked about that has to be fulfilled. Number three. Why should we, you know, what's the purpose of this man, you know, is to receive the answer to the disciples' prayer. That's an interesting one there. Because we pray, that's what you are taught. Our Father, who is it in heaven, hallowed be your name, the kingdom come, the will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come. That's profound, brothers and sisters. Now, that prayer, by the way, you see, it's disciples' prayer. Some people think it's the Lord's prayer. But in recent, it's not the Lord's prayer. It's the disciples' prayer. Because they asked God, "Lord, teach us how to pray." So it was disciples' prayer. The whole deal here is that all that prayer has been prayed all the time. You know, starting with the disciples' time. But it has not been fulfilled. His kingdom has not been fulfilled literally. And so that has to come for us to receive an answer to this prayer. Number four, the last one there. To re-emphasize the purpose for this millennial kingdom is to re-emphasize man's depravity and the necessity of Christ's death. It's to re-emphasize how man is so depraved, how man is just really wicked. You know, and just to show that the necessity of Christ the death, that Christ died, yes, Christ had to die on the cross to save mankind because mankind is just totally dead in his sin. Why do I say this? Now, in our text, Revelation 20 verses 3, talked about that Satan will be released for a ritual while. You saw that? You saw that? That after 1,000 years, Satan will be released loose for a short while. And what is he going to do? Verses 7 and 8 and 10. Yeah, 7 to 9, talk about that. What is he going to do? He's going to go to the world. Remember, this world whereby we have been reigning with Christ and try to deceive people. Again, by the way, that has been the mission of Satan. Is to deceive people. That's what he has been doing all the time. That's what he started with Adam and Eve. That's what he's doing even right now. Is to deceive mankind. So, interesting here. This is interesting. After he'll be released for a short time, he will go to the mission. Remember, we have been living with Christ and trying to deceive people to follow him. Interesting that the Bible says that there are some people who will follow him. Many will follow him. Now, that's interesting. This is why I say it's interesting. Because remember, Christ is reigning. He's one who is king. He's still there. And Satan is less loose. And some people are going to decide not to follow Christ, but to fall to Satan, to fall in his camp. That just tells you how mankind is so depraved. How mankind, you see, everything is there. Christ is there. There is peace. There is prosperity. Everything is there. But Satan will come and will get a follower. That tells you that it's not the environment, it's not training, it's not education. That's the fundamental problem of man. It is sin. That's why Christ had to come and die to deal with sin. And so that shows that man is just so depraved, but Christ had to come and die for man because there's nothing we could do to set ourselves free. So let me finish by talking about the characteristic or what characterizes this millennial kingdom. What is the profile of the millennial kingdom? I'm going to talk about five and I'll be done. Just five. Just five, brothers and sisters. So it will be a time of great peace. I'm almost there, don't worry. It will be a time of great peace. That's nice. You know, we have all this, you know, in the world today, we are looking for peace, United Nations, all over, you know, let's have peace. But you see, it's going to take God himself to have peace. It's going to take God himself. You know, Micah chapter 4 verse 3 talks about this, that he shall judge between many people. He shall decide for strong nations far away, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they run war anymore. No war, no lifting of, you know, weapons against one another. It will be a time of peace. Isaiah talks about that, 11. Verse 6 to 9 talks about that there will be peace even in animals, you know, that kids will be spending time with cobras, you know. Time of peace. This time it will be a greater time of great peace. Number two, it will be a time of prosperity. Prosperity. You see, that's what we are seeking. I want to prosper. I want my things to be okay. I want the church to prosper. I want my family. You know, that's what we are seeking. But all these brothers and sisters is going to be really be fulfilled at the millennial kingdom. A time of prosperity. Ezekiel talked about this. Ezekiel 34 verse 26 to 27 talked about prosperity. Amos 9 verses, chapter 9 verses 13 talks about that. Isaiah chapter 35 verse 1 talks about this, that the wilderness and the dry land shall be glad, the desert shall rejoice and blossom like the crocus, the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the lost. You see, time of great prosperity, the place where we have come to name the desert, those would be the most productive place at that time. You see, this is where the song comes true, that the curse will be removed from the earth. Joy to the world song. Time of great prosperity, brothers and sisters. Number three, it should be a time of purity. Time of purity. Sin will be kept in check. Remember, and this is why, because there will be presence of something. That's why, you know, Satan will be able to deceive some. Remember, we are having people after the Great Tribulation. There are people who will not take the mark of the beast, who will not take those, you know, those. And so they are going to come to the millennial kingdom, and they will be bearing kids. Remember, we, you know, who are coming with Christ, we have glorified bodies, and we are laying with Christ. But there will be, so there will be, have, you know, there will be children, there will be, you know, kids and people populate the world then. And by the way, that's going to be out there because a person, that's what Isaiah, I think, yeah, I'll be talking about that next sentence here. But it will be a time of great purity. There will be, Christ will rule in righteousness and his kingdom will be holy. Isaiah 11 verse 9 talks about this, says this. They shall not hurt or destroy in my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the water covers the sea. You see, time of great purity. Zechariah chapter 13 verse 3 talks about that. This time, Zechariah 8 verses 23, you have those verses in your handouts, talks about this, that thus says the Lord of hosts, in those days, 10 men from the nation of every tongue shall take hold of the law of Jews, saying, let us go with you, for you have heard that God is with us. Time of the purity, people coming together and living, you know, in the right way. Number two, it will be a time of prolonged life. This is what I meant to say. Time of prolonged life. Isaiah says this, Isaiah 65 verses 20, that a 100-year-old person, if somebody dies at 100 years, a person will be considered a child. That at 100 years, a person will be considered a child. This will be a time of a prolonged life. This guy will be going back to the, you know, to the Old Testament, especially in Genesis, whereby people are dying at 980, 800 years old, or like Methuselah, 961, almost 1,000. So this is the way it will be. This will be a characteristic, a time of prolonged life. And finally, it will be a time of personal joy. Personal joy. Because of the rule of Christ. Christ will reign. Isaiah talked about this in Isaiah chapter 14, verse 7. That the whole earth is at rest and quiet and break forth into singing. When was the last, you know, break forth into singing, you know, just time of great quiet, time of joy, personal joy in each and every person. Precious people, this is something we can account and wait for. That our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ is coming back. And when he comes back, he's going to establish this millennial kingdom. We have seen that, yes, the church will be raptured, will be with Christ for 7 years. Then they are going to come back with Christ to establish this 1,000 years, which we just talked about. Time of prolonged life, time of joy, time of prosperity, time of purity, we can count on. So the day is coming, and Paul talked about this, saying that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. So it's not a matter of if we are going to confess Jesus is Lord, it's when. And probably you are here and you have never confessed Christ as Lord. You can do it today. You can say yes to Christ. Confess him as Lord and Savior, and you'll be with him in this lane. This that we can all wait for, we can all long for, that he is coming to establish 1,000 years in this world. Probably you are here and you have never said yes to Christ, and you want to say it today. I want to pray with you. You have never said yes to Christ, and you want to say it today. I want to pray with you. Those of us who we have received Christ as our Lord and Savior, my encouragement to you in this year, 2013, and myself, this has been my prayer this week, that Lord, help me to be faithful with the time, with the resources, with what you have given me, Lord, so that I can maximize my time here. I can be faithful with the riches that you have given me here, so that you can account for me many at that time as you come to the world and give me more responsibility in the millennial kingdom. We can all wait for that, brothers and sisters. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful. We are so thankful because of your word. And thank you so much because your first coming was as it was spoken by the prophet. And everything concerning your first coming came exactly to the detail. We just remembered that few weeks ago about you being born in Bethlehem and you going to Nazareth, to Egypt, just as the prophet had predicted more than 500 years before your coming. And it came true. And you see, this is just a great confirmation to us, and we thank you so much for your word, that even your second coming, your establishment of your millennial kingdom will be as real, will be as ritual, will be as practical as your prophets have spoken in your word. And Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word, which is so real, which is out there, so true, and we can account on it. And therefore, Lord, we thank you this morning. We thank you for the time to dig into your word and help us to wait for your coming. And as we wait for your coming, help us to be faithful with what you have entrusted us with. We thank you and we praise you and thank you for this morning. We commit this year to you. We don't know what's in February. We don't know what's in September. You know, probably you have come by then. We don't know. But our prayer, Lord, help us to be faithful. Help us to give ourselves this year more than before for your honor and for your glory. We commit this church to you. Help us to grow in this year, in your knowledge, in number. We just want to pray that we go with your pace. Take this church to the next height, to where you want to be for your honor and for your glory. We thank you and we praise you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you and have a blessed day.